You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames Podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. Well, this week, it's all about friendly Midwesterners, the headwaters of the Hooch, and some trail magic. Join us as LiteShoe takes us on the Appalachian Trail, and she teaches us all about her loafing method of hiking the AT. You're listening to my friend Jan LiteShoe's Tales of the AT Through Hike, and my name is Anna. All my friends, of course, call me Mudbutt, and we're really glad you found us here at the Trail Dames Podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. Day 8, also March 8. Though my mountaintop camp was quiet when I rolled into the tent last night, within a few hours, the wind picked up and roared, leading to periods of uneasy sleep. I had forgotten to look up when I pinched my tent. I hoped there were no dead branches above my sil nylon ceiling. I don't know if it's my decades of working with horses, who are very skittish in the wind, or if everyone feels it, but the roar of the wind induces a gut-level disquiet. It's a primal thing. It keeps the body slightly on edge. Time to break camp before the rains come. I awoke in a cloud of wet mist, visibility 10 feet. Over the morning, the wind scours the mountaintops and blows the clouds back to 20 feet, 50 feet. Then finally, normal visibility with no views. I pass a campsite with two men in the first mile, but it is so foggy and the wind is so loud that they don't even notice me, even though I'm only 12 to 15 feet away. Despite the roar of the wind, a thrush flutes its melody across the wood. The notes, though single, sound almost as if there is harmony. Someone recently told me the name of the southern thrush that I was likely hearing, and I've forgotten it already. Up north, it will be the hermit thrush that awakens me, a bird pointed out by my long trail friend, Suze. More birds keep me company as I walk. A whole flock of robins flow down the trail as I approach, lightning then rolling down trail another 15 feet. They could easily fly to the side, so I wonder if they aren't just curious about me. I roll in from early lunch at Deep Gap Shelter, home of some bear problems for the last few years, according to Pilgrim. Two week-long hikers from the Midwest roll in to join me, maize and blue, and they cook up something that's better smelling than my tuna and trail bar. I utter the first few words from my mouth in the past 20 hours. Hello. They seem kind of dour at first, but I assume they're just tired, as am I. Sure enough, they exhibit friendly Midwestern behavior as soon as they get some food into them. Glory of glories, the sun has come out, so I fluff out my tent, socks, and damp bag to dry. The sound of running water past the shelter serenades me as I jot this. The afternoon is easy walking up a very old, overgrown logging road. I leapfrog with the Michigan brothers. The sun scours the land and lifts the spirits. Hot, even. Hard to believe it's winter here. Although that is the mountains, just wait a minute and it will change. The sun grows so warm that I actually heat up and I stick my head under a little waterfall to cool off. This gambit is so successful that the next pool I strip off my hiking shirt and I rinse out the underarms. Just bits now. I'm not yet quite brave enough to put on an entire soaking wet long sleeve shirt. It goes a long way towards quelling the hiker's stank, and I feel refreshed. Anthropological note. After a few days in the woods, one acquires a certain aromatic patina, if you will, that goes beyond mere stink. Thus, the use of the more colorfully descriptive hiker term, stank. About 3 p.m., I crossed Chattahoochee Gap, where water is available. Forget that. Last time I did this section, I hiked down there to see the fabled headwaters of the Chattahoochee, the Deliverance River. It was half a mile down and very steep. The headwater were a little trickle from the base of a rock. Been there, got the bumper sticker. I will make do with what I have. Thank you very much. Blue Mountain Shelter looks to be the destination tonight. That would make it a 12.5 mile day. A bit steep for the feet this early in the game. So I walk 12 to 14 mile days when I section hike. I can also go home to heal. This time, I'm in for the long haul. It is tempting to hustle and catch up with my friends, but I made myself a promise to hold it to 10 miles for a while. Unless you've carried a heavy pack over mountains, it is hard to believe what a difference 2 miles make on the old dogs at the end of the day. I vow to take an easy day tomorrow. Good thing, too, because by the time I get to the shelter, my feet are aching and my Achilles tendons are sore at the heels. It is a sensation I remember from the long trail. I expect to hurt, but I don't want to do any damage. The shelter is full of young guys and a girl, also a Springer Spaniel named Bradley, who chases the mice. Good dog, Bradley. Maze and Blue roll in later, also complaining of sore feet. They joke around, and at dark, someone builds a fire. I sleep soundly, and no mice are detected. LiteShoe, AT class of 03. Day 9, another chilly morning. My bladder drives me from the sleeping bag and into the cold. You thought it was summer yesterday, eh, sister? On the way back, I grab my food bag and I cook up a pot of oatmeal. Then I retire back shivering to my bag and I eat it, layered and fluffy down. The group in the shelter starts to stir. No, says one, don't make me put my pack on again. Bradley, the Springer Spaniel, pokes his head up from the hammock. His master Patrick had taken him up with him during the night. I have to snap a picture of this. The sun rose directly in front of the shelter, putting on a show. Maze and Blue are getting off the trail today and they're returning to the Midwest. They stocked me up on ibuprofen, bless their post-40 hearts. Last night, my feet just throbbed and throbbed, keeping me awake. What a bunch of unmotivated thru-hikers, jeers a weekender. That does it. I want a laid-back, but motivated hike, and he is right. I get a late start and leave the youngsters still huddled in their bags. The wind is so cold this morning it gives me a headache, blowing right through my hat. The young people are good kids, but they are still sorting out life, and their humor with each other tends to be a shade on the negative side. A certain enthusiasm for the venture is lacking, and I miss the excited folks of the first few days. Though they are very polite to me, I find myself longing for more upbeat, motivated company. I wonder where the very supportive Pack 31 is today. On the way down the stony flank of Blue Mountain, I meet the ridge runner. His name is John, or quote-unquote Big Stick, no doubt in reference to the large walking pole he hikes with. He tells me there's trail magic ahead. Yes! We chat for a while and I feel from him the positive vibes I was missing. At the info board at Unicoi Gap, it's true. There are treats galore, plus fuel and Gatorade. Fresh donuts! I eat a pastry on the spot, and what's this? A gallon of fresh orange juice? I pour a glass. Heaven! I may be the only hiker on the AT this year to gain weight. Thus fortified, I eyed a long pull out of Unicoi Gap. I did this section last year, almost exactly to the day, and I remember it well. A truck pulls up and two friendly faces pop out. It's Heather and Andy from Pack 31. Here's some enthusiastic company. They got off the trail for 3 days to rest. Heather's been having excruciating knee pain in about the same place I used to. She's all taped and braced up. We compared joint supports like old people. I showed her my Chopat dual action knee brace. So far, knock wood, there's been no pain there. Everywhere else, but the knees are golden at this point. I let them go ahead since today is a loafing day for me. I decided on the hard-charging long trail trip last August that my AT trek was going to be the epitome of unhurried. Unhurried does not mean unmotivated. It means a conscious effort to slow down and go at a pace with which my frame is happy. So today, I finally keep that promise. On the uphills, I pass by no rock or log that calls my name. Off comes the pack at many of these fine sitting spots. Sometimes I sit just to hear the silence, or rather, the breeze and the birds. Somewhere up the long hill, though, I take my hat off and forget it. Bad thing, Martha. A person needs a hat in the late winter in North Georgia. When I come to the cheese factory site with its lovely flat mountain meadow, I can no longer resist. I pull out my Z-Rest foam mat and I have a nap in the sun, which by now has mellowed considerably. Why anyone would build a cheese factory on a North Georgia mountaintop beats me. Maybe they were Swiss and were used to such things. I woke to the brown eyes of Spike the Boxer. Spike is ecstatic to see me. I miss my goofy little dog, Pogo. Spike's owner are out for a spring break of camping, and we chat for a while. More positive, enthusiastic young people. Trey Mountain, at over 4,900 feet, is quite high for the North Georgia AT. Our tallest so far, I believe. And it's hard. Well, what else is new? But I love its rocky top and grand views. The sun is blazing now, and the sky is that deep blue that looks like one could just float away on it. I promised the bod an easy day. Trey Mountain Shelter is just 7.6 miles from Blue Mountain. That should do it for the rest of this loafing day. But after an early supper and a nap, it's only 4:30, and the old frame is restless. Any miles more I do today come off the 10-plus I'll do tomorrow. Why not hike a little more and make a wilderness camp? Because I am starting to hear Hiawassee and a hot shower call my name. I hadn't planned on being there until March 13th, but suddenly it looks like cleanliness and blueberry pancakes could be mine as early as the eve of the 11th. My birthday is on March 12th, so that would be super sweet. I check in with the bod, since it has the last word on this hike. All systems are go except for the feet. And they're only grumbling a little, a good many hours from outright rebellion. I am starting to see benefits on day one of the loafing method of AT hiking. The walking in late afternoon is so fine, so sunbathed, so rolling, that I just keep on trucking against expectation 2 more hours to Blue Ridge Swag. Along the way, I see some fine old growth oaks, crowns broken out, huge girth covered in knobs and burls. I nod my respects to Los Viejos as I pass. I am on a roll. Some days just flow. But it is 6:30 p.m. now, and the sun is dropping to the far ridges. I am gliding on the trail, hoping for a flat spot at the bottom when I am hailed. Andy and Heather again. Too perfect. We chat while they finish their supper, and I hang my food bag on their bare line. Heather said her knees are holding up just fine. We watch the sunset go red, then dark, and then we retire. I take some of the Midwestern ibuprofen and I tote up the miles. About 11. Oops. Well, tomorrow will be under 8 miles with only Kelly Knob to bust me. For once, I set up my Nomad 242 perfectly. And there is no sag. I wish I knew how I did that. Well, I have months to practice. LiteShoe, AT class of 03. I have always been a dreamer since